Welcome everybody. I'm Gunter Miegel. I have a background in system engineering, and I'm taking care about IT infrastructures since 10 years. And today I want to talk about CoinBoot, cost-effective diskless GPU clusters for blockchain hashing and beyond. Yeah, let's start. Beginning 2017, there was this emerging cryptocurrency boom. So the company I was working for at this time got a customer who ordered 20 overseas containers packed with computers for cryptocurrency mining. Mining is cryptocurrency lingo for taking part in the generation of new blocks to a blockchain for a reward. The most popular cryptocurrency, Bitcoin, is mined with special hardware, as you may know. And other cryptocurrencies, like for instance the Ether of the Ethereum project, is generated mostly with GPUs. So the customer wanted 20 overseas containers for GPU mining. So we crammed nearly 5,000 nodes and 30,000 GPUs in these containers, split in 240 nodes and 1,440 GPUs in each container. So the emphasis was on minimal total cost of ownership to maximize the return of investment. So commodity hardware was the first choice. The customer ordered not only the hardware, but also the software stack to run and operate the hardware. Though I came up with a solution. But at first, let's take a look at the hardware. There I have a video for you showing you the hardware and the production facility. Oops, sorry, wrong screen. Let's go. Wait. So this is the production facility. You see the hardware there. The hardware is besides the 6 AMD GPUs on the low end, Celeron GPUs, 4 gigabytes of RAM, no BMC, no APMI, 1 gigabit Ethernet. The containers you see here are air-cooled, and they have an electrical power consumption of 250 kilowatts each, so a lot of electrical energy is going in there. And we also have produced water-cooled containers. Okay, video is done. Let's see if I come out of full screen without any harm. Okay, yeah, not working. Just ignore the bot bar on the top. Yeah, so this is the hardware we got. So now the initial approach. The initial approach for the deployment of the software stack was the following. Create a golden image of the OS, plus the configuration and additional software, and deploy it during the production on the cheap USB flash drive. After the first container was completed, we switched it on and we recognized that around 10% of all nodes did not come up properly. Though, as we find out, there was a race condition between the initialization of the controller of the USB flash drive and the storage initialization of the mainboard firmware. So sometimes it happened that the USB flash drive was not fast enough to be recognized by the mainboard as disk. So then a workaround was put in place, and it was the following: bootloader over network. In this case, grub. Grub had some logic to determine if an USB flash drive was initialized successfully, and if this was the case, booting would proceed from this disk drive. Else shut down the node properly, and we later switched on the node again via Bacon LAN and hope that booting next time succeeds. So the workaround was working. We were busy with the production and shipping of all the containers. We had a working setup, but I got an idea for further optimization. Can we drop the unreliable USB flash drive at all? So the USB flash drives we use, they are just costing €5 for 32 gigabytes, and they have, as you recognize by this workaround, they have a lot of issues. So the idea of getting rid of the disk comes with some pros and cons. And one pro is cutting costs by having no USB flash drive, no workaround for boot failures anymore, and we could also streamline our production and operations procedures because this slow USB drives, they really make real trouble also in production and in operations. And the cons are mostly constraints by hardware and software, though we have only 1 gigabyte of network. The golden image we have created has a size of 4 gigabyte. The RAM is also 4 gigabytes. And the proprietary GPU driver we need for the cryptocurrency mining is only available for Ubuntu, Red Hat, and SUSE Linux. The preferred OS by the customer and by my team was Ubuntu. And the main conflict is between the size of the golden image and the size of the RAM. So if you put this golden image on the RAM, you don't have any memory left for running the system. Okay, so the main topic to go diskless was to get an OS image that is less bulky. Less bulky because it has to fit in the RAM. And also to reduce the network load. So I set myself a goal, less or equal 200 megabytes of volume to be transferred over the network for booting a node. Besides this, the image should be bootable via network, of course, and able to run diskless without any further storage devices. Because I'm quite lazy, as most of you probably. I don't want to reinvent the wheel. Though such a tiny distribution supporting network booting and running diskless should already exist. I did know that in the HPC domain, diskless was done since ages. So I searched for distributions in this HPC domain, a special tailored HPC distribution, and I found, for instance, ROX, OpenHPC, and Xcat. So none of them seem to be a good match. ROX, yes, is CentOS-based. OpenHPC is SUSE or CentOS-based, and Xcat, TLTR, a very complex project, mostly written in Perl. I don't want to spend my time on this. It seems to work quite well, but I doubted that I could integrate, for instance, the graphics driver there. Yeah, and then there are the new kids on the block, like CoreOS and its primary fork, Flatcore Linux. Both are known as lightweight distros and are able to run diskless. So I looked at both. But both were 100% about the threshold of 200 megabytes. So they need 400 megabytes of image size for booting a node. Yeah, this is why I would call them lightweight, but yet too bulky for my use case. Sorry to the Flatcore Linux and CoreOS people, you do a good job, but you cannot help me in my use case. So I had to slowly convince myself to create something on my own. I proposed my idea to the project leader of the mining container project. He liked the idea, asked me for an estimation about the effort for a proof of concept to report to a supervisor. I said, give me 4 weeks. To make a long story short, the company had no further interest to look deeper into this idea. But I was stubborn, curious, and eager, and did it as a side project in my free time. So, while working on this as a side project, the proof of concept took me 4 months. Most time was spent on getting rid of the unnecessary libraries, modules, documentation, and header files, and all the stuff that you don't need to run an operating system and getting the job done. Taking apart the massive proprietary GPU driver was also an endeavor of this whole project. And I stripped it down to the bare minimum. The initial commit I did on October 2017, proof of concept was finished on March 2018. Then I got stuck in a corporate roundabout for a while. And what should I say, at the end I was able to publish all as open source at August 2018. What I got? Yeah, I got lightweight PXE booting with an image size of 104 5 megabyte for kernel 4.15 and an image size of 155 megabyte for kernel 5.0. I get diskless worker nodes, configured real environments, a plug-in system, a coin boot server Docker container. I'm using iPixie with remote logging, which is very handy if you want to debug the remote booting process on all these nodes. I got support for legacy PXE and UFI network boot as well. And mostly important to move fast in the development process is I got testing with Travis CI. On Travis CI, I test, the Coinboot Docker server container, and I'm spawning multiple QEMU VMs in the Travis CI instance to see if network booting is working at all. And, of course, daily builds and releases of the images. Yeah, as new updates and upgrades come through the the distribution which this is based on, the Ubuntu, I'm rebuilding the image every day. Okay. So let's have a look at the toolset to build the SlideWide OS images. A bootloader needs two files to boot a Linux system. At first, a compressed Linux executable called Forum Linux. Why it's called Forum Linux? It's a long history. And an initial root file system called InitRAMFS. So I was looking for a tool to build that, and I found DebEarth, which is also tailored towards running diskless, so obvious a good match. DebEarth is an abbreviation for Debian on initial RAM file system. DebEarth is part of the current Debian and Ubuntu releases, and you can easily install it, but sadly, the last activities upstream on this project were 10 years ago, and even if it's in the official releases of Ubuntu, it's broken. The images you can create with it do not boot properly. There were some systemd related patches required, which I've done. DebEarth is at the end just a nice wrapper for Deb Bootstrap with the possibility to run scripts to adapt your build root for a system. DebEarth is calling this a profile. So I created a profile for DebEarth. For that I customized the early user space process. Though, to use a compressed RAM disk for the root file system and having the capability of loading plugins to extend worker nodes at boot time with functionality. So now let's take a look at the customized early user space process I created. But at first, we have to look at that there are two types of running diskless nodes. Type A is without centralized storage, where the rootfs is on the local RAM of the working node only, and type B with rootfs on centralized storage and accessed over NFS or iSCSI, for instance. And of course, we go for A because B is not playing well with our commodity 1 gigabit network. So the early user space has to support rootfs on the local RAMFS. So I came up with a two-staged early user space. The first stage is running slash init. It's an initial boot script, and it's based on a minimal BusyBox environment. It creates a Z-RAM disk with SCD compression for the root file system. Then it extracts the final rootfs archive on this compressed RAM disk. After that, it pivots root to this file system and hand over to init 2 of the final stage. Slash init is what you found in all classical Linux systems for booting, but it extended it and added a second stage, which is called init 2. Init 2 launches and triggers systemd utfd to get all devices up and running, for instance, the network interface card. Then it is downloading and extracting the plugins to the root file system on the compressed RAM drive. Then it's downloading and adding the environment file to etc environment. And after that, it handovers to systemd with calling aspen init to finalize the boot process. And in future, there's a plan to directly mount a SquashFS image at the first stage. Yeah, now some fancy graphs. Let's talk about RAM compression with STD for the root file system. The RAM drive compression of CoinBoot is using STD compression, the STD compression algorithm. Thanks to Jan Collet from Facebook and the other contributors for this excellent project. As you may remember, yesterday there was a lightning talk about STD given by a colleague from Ivan, and he had shown their use of STD. So it's a really sophisticated compression algorithm. STD is in the kernel since 4.14, I guess, so late November 2017. It's the fastest high compression ratio compression algorithm you can currently get. It can be also used for a compressed RAM drive with ZRAM. So with a root file system on ZRAM with STD compression, you get much less shared memory usage and overall more memory available for the system in comparison to a rootFS on TempFS, which is the classical approach for diskless nodes. Yeah, you may recognize that this blue bar, which is completely missing or very tiny in the on the ZRAM section there. This is basically the shared memory, which is allocated in TempFS completely for the root file system. And if you look at the memory available, so the green bar, you have quite more memory available if you use that RAM and STDD RAM disk compression. Okay, so the next topic is booting is tricky these days. Mainboards come with a wide range of default boot options. So for instance, legacy, BIOS PXE, UEFI PXE, UEFI HTTP boot, and so on. Touching the firmware configuration of thousands of mainboards in production was absolutely not feasible. To cope with that, I came up with the following solution. I'm using DNS mask as a DHCP server, and I configured DNS mask like that, that it's setting a tag based on the data provided by the DHCP client DHCP request. And based on this tag, different bootloaders got delivered with the DHCP acknowledgement. Yeah. Okay. So next topic is, as I already mentioned, configuration via environment variables. I think this is well known from working with containers already. You have one central environment file at the CoinBoot server where you can tweak the environment variables for your whole cluster. And this environment variables are then available at each worker node. Plugins. Get all you need. CoinBoot plugins extend nodes with functionalities. CoinBoot plugins are just a set of file system changes packed in a compressed archive. At boot time, they are downloaded from the worker node, from the CoinBoot server by the worker node, and the worker node is this downloaded archive is then extracted on his root file system. Plugins are created with CoinBoot Maker, and I also created an experimental way to keep the Debian Package Manager database in a wallet state when using CoinBoot plugins. Okay, let's talk about CoinBoot Maker. CoinBoot Maker is used to build CoinBoot plugins. CoinBoot Maker, for this case, takes just an init RAMFS, a CoinBoot init RAMFS. Then it runs C to create a container with this init RAMFS as baseline. This container has OverlayFS as backing file system. And then with this file system, changes are tracked in the backing file system. So you just install whatever you want on your working node there. And when done with the changes, The files to be part of the plugin get collected and packed as an archive. This archive is then placed on the CoinBoot server. And during boot, it will be downloaded and extracted by the worker node and to be placed on the root file system. Yeah. CoinBoot server. Yeah. Let's give some short hints how to use CoinBoot server. So it's a central component for booting your cluster. So there's a quick start guide available under this URL. There is a Docker container which brings all services required. So basically DNS mask for TFTP and DHCP and Nginx for HTTP. It's all pre-configured. So just use it. So clone the repo for CoinBoot and then configure the DHCP range. So that it reflects the range of IP addresses you want to hand out to your cluster nodes. Then that's a mandatory environment variable CoinBoot server IP, which is basically should basically be the IP address, the Docker host you spawn the CoinBoot server is available, should be. The kernel and initial DynamFS of CoinBoot are downloaded automatically when you spawn up the container. If you want a different version of the kernel and the initial DynamFS, you can specify this in the environment file. So let's go, just make a Docker Compose up, wait a short amount of time until all services are up and running of the CoinBoot server, and then switch on your worker nodes and see the magic happened. Okay, so I'm already at the summary of my talk. CoinBoot can run GPU-based blockchain hashing on GPU clusters with a minimal TCO. By using RAM drive compression with STD diskless, worker nodes have more usable memory available, and CoinBoot is easily extensible and can run various other number crunching workloads, of course. So what's next? There's an ongoing transition to a monorepo because a CoinBoot consists of a lot of sub-projects and it's completely mess to work with them. So I working on moving to a monorepo and of course going out of the beta status as well. There's TensorFlow for AMG GPUs coming to CoinBoot, support for NVIDIA GPUs. There's a plan to use peer-to-peer plugin loading with the local BitTorrent stream, using SquashFS and OverlayFS for the root file system, and there is also the plan to giving mining hardware a second life, because at some point in time mining is no longer profitable, and CoinBoot will probably be being part of a platform that makes GPUs accessible for the machine learning and data science community. Yeah, so. At last, some thanks. I want to thank Julie and Elmo, Steve Schmeller, who convinced me to apply here, Esther and Barbazi for the photos, Jaime, Comeda, Gomez Allier, and Lucas Reyes of Cloud and Heat for their support, Cloud and Heat for the video material, Subramanaya, Shankar, Yoshi for being the best unicorn whisperer ever. And now you can ask me questions or you can ask them later. Thank you.